gentlemen, been over the rules with you both, you know what I expect. Touch gloves. Good luck.
You ready? Mark, you ready? 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 Box!
Four. reaches the count of 10. Your winner by way of knockout victory, his fourth consecutive and fourth professional victory from Palmdale, California, Cesar Omar Diaz.
Ladies and gentlemen, keep it going for Cesar Diaz. And now, ladies and gentlemen, making his way into the ring with a very exciting 100% knockout ratio, the very exciting Virgil Ortiz!
All right, ladies and gentlemen, we are set to go with our next bout tonight. Four rounds, this in the super lightweight division. Introducing to you first, fighting out of the blue corner, wearing black trunks trimmed in white, he weighed in officially 139¼ pounds. In 8 professional bouts, his record stands at 5 victories, 3 defeats, 2 wins coming by way of knockout, del Distrito Federal Mexico, here is Israel Biela. And his opponent across the ring, fighting out of the red corner, wears tonight black trimmed in silver. He weighed in 139½ pounds and in 3 professional bouts, stands perfect with 3 victories. No defeats, all 3 wins by way of knockout. From Dallas, Texas, here is the undefeated Virgil Ortiz Jr. And your referee in charge of the action is Ray Corona.
Good. Touch gloves if you want. God bless.
Ready.
comes to the official time, 1:26. Round number one, we have your winner by KO victory. He is still undefeated, Virgil Ortiz Jr.
Fantasy Springs, Indio, keep it going right now for Knockout Artist, 100% and still going, Virgil Ortiz Jr.
Up next, there we go. Now I don't hear the left ear.
Undefeated prospect from Washington, D.C., Lamont Gross Jr.
Here we go, fine. One, two. There we go, there we go. There we go. Thank you, guys. About an hour and a half, 2 hours east of downtown Los Angeles, Fantasy Springs Resort and Casino. That's where we are tonight for another edition of Golden Boy Promotions. Exciting fights coming your way from the Coachella Valley. Inside the special event center at the Fantasy Springs Resort and Casino, first fight coming your way, super featherweight division from the District, Washington, D.C.'s own undefeated fighter, Lamont Roach Jr. takes on veteran Mexican Alex Valdez. 8 rounds, that's with the WBC youth belt on the line. And then after that, 18-year-old Luis Cordia, he's still in high school, packs a big punch, 2-0 with 2 KOs, takes on rugged Mexican Gerardo Molina. 4 rounds in the featherweight division. And that's all working towards the main event tonight on HBO. WBC belt on the line, El Bandido Francisco Vargas takes on fellow Mexican Miguel Burchelt, who's only got one loss on his record, and he's coming for the upset. That's the main event in Indio, California. Alongside the editor of RingTV.com and one of the best boxing scribes out there, Doug Fisher, I'm Bethel Duran. Thank you for joining us this afternoon or evening, wherever you might be watching, whether you're in the district, whether you're in LA, whether you're driving around Southern California. Fighters are getting ready to make their way. We've already had two Golden Boy fighters with impressive knockouts. Cesar Diaz from Palmdale, California. He is now 4-0 with 4 KOs. He got a second round stoppage over veteran Joel Cano. And then from Grand Prairie, Texas, outside of Dallas, Virgil Ortiz Jr. He's 18. He also improved to 4-0 with 4 KOs in a first round big knockout over Israel Vieira, the Mexican from Mexico City. And two Golden Boy fighters out of Joel Diaz's camp looking good early on. And this will be a night, Doug, where Vargas and Burchill is going to be the main event. That's going to be some fireworks.
Yeah, and I can't wait for that. You know, as a boxing writer, you always want to be present for great fights, for the kind of fights that people are talking about years later, even decades later. I take a lot of pride at being ringside for all three fights between Eric Morales and Marco Antonio Barrera.
All three?
Yeah, or being there for the first fight between Diego Corrales and Jose Luis Castillo. And, of course, Vargas is the kind of fighter who makes for those type of fights. His last two fights were hands down fight of the year, and these are the kind of fights. His war with Takashi Miura, who's in tonight's co-feature against Mickey Roman, and against Orlando Salido, who I'm told is here tonight. These are the kind of fights that people don't just talk about the year they happen. They talk about them for years to come.
Vargas, Burchill, the main event, the co-feature from Japan, Takashi Miura and Mexican Mickey Roman. Making his way into the ring right now is Alex Valdez. Ciudad Obregón, Sonora, Mexico is where he's from. Valdez, 26-8-2. It would be a good test for young Lamont Roach Jr. at a Team No Excuse gym in Washington, D.C. Look at some of the highlights as they're making their way into the ring.
These are going to be highlights of Lamont Roach Jr. He was a terrific amateur standout out of the D.C. area, D.C. Maryland area, and you can see why. He's got speed, fluidity, technique, and as he advances in his pro career, he's sitting down more on his punches. I think for this fight against Mario, he, for the first time utilized a strength and conditioning coach to increase his physical durability and his punching power, and it paid off.
Lamont Rhodes Jr. making his way into the ring. That was the Belasco Theater in Los Angeles. Going across the country, there you see him with his dad and uncle in his corner. No Excuse Gym in Washington, D.C. Go and check it out. That's a poppy gym. Also has Demetrius Ballard, Big Meech, a super middleweight in the Golden Boy stable. Also, Rivers Jr. out there. So send us your tweets. I'm Duran Sports. Dougie is Dougie Fisher, I.E. Doug's Mailbag every Friday and a Monday. Thanks for your watching, whether you're just leaving the gym in downtown L.A. or as Vice President Golden Boy Monica Sears is watching right now. We're led by Will Wright and David Tatro.
Championship. This bout is sanctioned by the WBC President Mauricio Suleiman and representative in attendance Lee Peters. The three judges scoring at ringside of the 10-point must system, Rudy Barragán, Sergio Caiz, and Fernando Villarreal. When the bell rings, your referee in charge of the action, Eddie Hernandez. And here we go, fight fans, introducing to you first, fighting out of the blue corner. Wearing red trunks, he weighed an officially 132 and 1/2 pounds. This veteran has 26 victories, including 20 knockouts, 8 defeats, and 2 draws. Desde la Ciudad Obregón, Sonora, México, presentando Alex Valdez. And across the ring stands his opponent, fighting out of the red corner. Wearing tonight red, trimmed in black and silver, he weighed an officially 130 pounds even. His record stands perfect in 12 bouts, 12 victories, no defeats, 4 wins coming by way of knockout. Hailing from our nation's capital of Washington, D.C., here is the undefeated Lamont Rhodes Jr.
Eddie Hernandez, the third man in the ring. We're ready to go. 8 rounds with a vacant WBC Youth Super Featherweight title on the line. Lamont Rhodes Jr., look at him, Dougie.
Yeah, obviously the glaring statistic here, the tail of the tape, is the age. At age 21, Lamont Rhodes Jr., definitely the younger fighter. Ironically, though, the man, his opponent, Alex Valdez, he began his career in the lighter weight classes, as light as bantamweight, where he was actually world class. He's the taller fighter tonight.
Lamont Rhodes Jr., orthodox fighter, black with the white trim around him. Valdez, the Mexican, southpaw, he's got the blue gloves. Said he found some tape of Roach thanks to go to the Ring TV's YouTube channel. So if you want to see some of the past footage of these fighters, the up-and-coming Golden Boy fighters, go to the Golden Boy YouTube page. Not only are we providing it for the fans, providing for the opponents. Good uppercut landing by Roach.
He can study Roach all he likes. He's going to have a hard time with the younger man's speed and sharp technique. Valdez obviously brings the experience, as I said, at bantamweight. That's 118 pounds. He was world class. He was a top bantamweight fighter at the start of 2006 through 2009, and he faced the best fighters that resided in that division at the time.
Good uppercut by Rhodes, drops Valdez here in the first round. Lamont Rhodes Jr. showing some pop here to open up his bout. Knock on him has been, he starts slow, he picks his spots. A little power here in the opening round against Valdez.
And Valdez is standing straight up and he's very slow, so he's not a hard target for Rhodes to find.
Oh, another body shot drops him here. And I don't know if Valdez is going to get up from that one. That one stuck and hurt. And it is over. A first round KO for Lamont Rhodes Jr. No Excuse Gym in Washington, D.C. They're fired up. A lot of family made the trip across the country. This is a kid that you have to keep an eye on. He's not a big promoter on social media about him. He's not bragging things. Really soft spoken. But there you see him with his dad. but the dude gets the job done. Really nice outing from Lamont Roach Jr.
Yeah, for the longest time, he got the job done by thoroughly outboxing and outpointing his opponents. But starting with his last fight, that third round knockout of Mario Macias, he got a taste of what it feels like to get a knockout on national television or on an international stream like on RingTV.com. And obviously, he likes it.
Oh, and they're loving it back home in Washington, D.C. A fighting family. His dad is his trainer. Uncle is also the trainer. Uncle with a... No, there you see the body shot. Look at this, Doug.
There's a right uppercut. Roach slipping punches, landing the right. That produced the first knockdown, and Valdez got up. He's been knocked down before. He always gets up and fights hard. And then it was a right to the solar plexus. That body shot put Valdez down for the count, and Valdez has never been wiped out like this. The only time he's been blown out was against Hozumi Hasegawa, a stellar bantamweight champion from Mexico who was the top bantamweight at the time. And that was at bantamweight, and he's never been blown out like that since.
No excuse, Jim. They're going crazy back in D.C. Five pros in that gym. And you know who else fired up? His younger brother, Jordan, 13 years old. He's actually going to the National Silver Gloves in April. Sister Taylor, Tia, his mom, all loving it. He recently did Lamont Roach Jr. see one of his friends, Gervonta Davis, win a belt. He said that fired him up because he knows Davis from the amateurs.
Referee Eddie Hernandez calls a halt to this bout. We have your winner by KO victory. He is still undefeated. And now the new WBC Youth Silver Super Featherweight Champion, Lamont Roach Jr.
They'll stop it for Lamont Roach Jr. He's now 13-0. Keep those tweets coming.
Congratulations.
And saludos a toda la gente que nos está mirando en Tamazula, Guadalajara, Jalisco,
WBC
Mexico, la familia Mendez. Also Nick Mendez, the pride of Notre Dame
World
High School in the Valley.
Gentlemen.
Just saw Lamont Roach Jr. look good here in the opening round. Pose for the social media.
He is the truth, ladies and gentlemen.
That's how you open up the year, huh? With the first round KO in front of Eric Gomez, President Golden Boy, in front of HBO Brass.
Yeah, and even though this guy was older and was coming up in weight, he was somebody who had been in with top-notch fighters like Fernando Montiel, and he gave him trouble. Or Neomar Semeno, who's a major belt holder at featherweight right now. This guy, Valdez, he went 11 rounds in a competitive fight against Sermeno. So this is, it's a great confidence booster for a 21-year-old prospect like Lamont Roach Jr. to just blast him out, for the fight to be no contest whatsoever. Because I do believe that the matchmakers expected Valdez, with his experience and being a southpaw, being tall and rangy, taller and rangier than Roach even, they expected Valdez to take him some rounds, show him some looks. It didn't happen.
And a shout out to everybody that's watching from USC, Vanessa Rivera, USC alumni, of course, the Sears family, Monica, loves USC. Couple more at USC, Edgar Navarro. USC people love watching Ring TV live, and because Lamont Roach Jr. actually attended University of Maryland for 1 year, was a mechanical engineering major, and realized that when you're trying to train to be an elite pro athlete,
you have to choose.
And going to math classes? Nah, I'd rather go run than go to math classes.
You have to either dedicate yourself to college, or you have to dedicate yourself to the sweet science. And he is a sweet practitioner in there. What I'd like to see from Roach, and I don't know if he's ready for it just yet, but maybe within the next two or three fights, I'd like to see him in with a similar opponent as Alejandro Valdez, but only somebody who's a natural junior lightweight, not somebody coming up from bantamweight or junior featherweight, somebody who is a veteran in the same vein as Valdez, only he is a full-bodied junior lightweight, or even a lightweight.
There you see, father, actually that's his uncle, firefighter.
Yeah, Bernard Roach.
Bernard Roach.
Yeah, and he's a stern taskmaster in the gym, and they have high expectations for him. They really want him to shine every time he steps into that ring. And I know we've called some fights with Roach where we thought he looked great, and Roach is going back to the corner, and his dad and Bernard are getting on his case, and I don't understand it. But they know they know what his potential is. They must see something in the gym that tells him that he can be explosive in the squared circle every time the he's under the big lights.
You know, Lamont has fought in Las Vegas with the distance. They weren't really happy about it. Fought in D.C. on the other card with the distance. They liked the result, but they wanted the pop, incorporating the strength and conditioning coach. Also, he's now 21, getting a little bit stronger. You see some thickness on his back.
Yeah, that's true.
And there you go. So everybody at No Excuse Gym, congratulations to you guys. Gym is fired up. Demetrius Ballard, I know you're watching. I mean, your time is coming too. Our main tonight, Francisco Vargas against fellow Mexican Miguel Burchelt. And that'll be a good one as Vargas, all over Mexico, he's a star down there, former Olympian, and he sat down with the Ring TV Live cameras.
Sí, es algo que me motiva, ¿no? Saber que otros peleadores quieren. Siempre que voy a pelear, pues subo con la mente de ganar y es lo único que tengo en la cabeza. Así aunque me estén pegando o vaya perdiendo, no sea, yo no dejo de competir, yo siempre quiero buscar ganar.
Vargas.
Soy un peleador que entrena fuerte y que quiere dar espectáculo, pero no pensé que fuera a ganar dos peleas del año y pues y ahora saber que cada que voy a subir al ring pues la gente espera verme pelear porque saben que va a haber una pelea de acciones.
Vargas letting his hands go a bit here in the second round. Uppercut nicely landed by Bandido.
Beautiful technique from Vargas.
Salido es un peleador muy resistente que aguanta mucho y que piensas que ya lo tienes, regresa, ¿no? Regresa y está ahí. Es un peleador que igual no se da por vencido y tira muchos golpes. Y pues creo que está bien la decisión y a ver si hay una pelea de desempate. Es un peleador joven. Pero yo creo que su principal peligro es que es la oportunidad del campeonato, pues va a venir con todo, ¿no? Porque es una oportunidad de ser campeón. Pues yo creo que va a venir muy motivado. Por lo mismo, igual nosotros sabíamos el compromiso que teníamos, trabajamos duro y pues vamos a estar listos para pelear con él. Y pues estuvimos entrenando bien y hicimos un buen campamento.
WBC Super Featherweight belt on the line. Before that, the co-main, Takashi Miura, rugged veteran from Ciudad Juarez, Mickey Roman. Miura Vargas, that was a fight, Doug, in Las Vegas. I wasn't calling it, but I was a huge fan that night. It was on the Canelo Cotto card. I was standing in the back with Nick Mendez, Monica Sears, and a lot of the other Golden Boy staff. We're watching this as it's developing. You're like, oh, there's something here. The first couple rounds, okay. All of a sudden, you felt the emotion in the building. You're like, okay, okay. And then Vargas with the big victory. That was a fight where like, oh, we still have Canelo to go. But it stole the thunder, a lot of people's fight of the year in 2015.
Yeah, it's a real fans fight. And if you were on press row, as I was, it made you forget that you're a professional, that you're a writer, that you're there to cover this. And you stand up and you cheer when the end result happened because it happened out of nowhere. It looked like Miura had taken over the fight. He had heaped unimaginable punishment on the face and body of Vargas in round 6, 7, and 8. He'd scored a knockdown, kind of turned the fight around in round 4. And then all of a sudden, with his back against the wall, with his eye totally closed, terrible cut, you're thinking they gotta stop it soon. And Vargas comes back and he stops the Japanese defending title holder. These are the kind of special moments that only happen in boxing.
And that was a fight where, you know, you don't, I'm not going to cuss here, but there was some DFUs around.
Oh, yeah.
Everything else yeah. going around.
Well, that's how you know you just saw something special.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
You know, like I said earlier, you know, I was there for all three fights between Morales and Barrera. I was there. I was ringside for Corrales Castillo 1. I was there for the rubber match between Israel Vasquez and Rafael Marquez. And these are the kind of fights where when it's done and you're a deadline writer, you don't even know where to start. You just sit there and you stare at that ring and you stare at your computer screen. You're like, how can I do this justice with mere words? You can't. The only way you can express yourself is with, oh, ooh, ah.
hey,
and you curse a little bit.
Hey, that's my tagline, my ooh, ah. Howard Cosell had the big famous lines. No, I'm simple. I'm ooh, ah, that's what I do. And that's what you were doing that entire fight.
That means you're a real fight fan. And you're just seeing these highlights as this fight warms up, as Miura is finding a home for that sledgehammer left. He's a southpaw. He lives and dies by his left hand, that power left. And Vargas, he's a boxer. He's a technician, but he's aggressive. And you know, Beto, you have great fighters, mm-hmm. and you have fighters who make for great fights.
Man,
that's right. He went down hard in that fourth round. And look at that terrible cut under the eye. Now, obviously, great fighters, they're sensational all around. They're awesome talents, and they have great skills. But fighters who make for great fights, they're great offensively, and then they're flawed elsewhere. And these guys, they're flawed. They're here to bang. They're not defensive wizards in there. They get hit. Their faces swell. They get cut. But they have the spirit to fight through that, and that's what fans just crave.
That was one where you're watching that fight, Miura and Francisco Vargas on the card here tonight. You know, people were anticipating a rematch for these two. Vargas went on and fought against Sirius Alito to a draw last June. And yeah, Miura would want that rematch. And Vargas would like that rematch. Because that's the one where that was a co-feature. Now that's a main event, especially with the belt. And fans, you let it marinate a little bit. And that's one where not even the hardcore fans are into it, obviously, but it's like the casual fan, like, yeah, I want to see these two guys.
Hey, listen, when Barrera and Morales first fought, I believe it was in early 2000 at the Mandalay Bay Event Center, which seats about 13,000 fans, they cut the arena in half. It was like a little over 6,000. It was just for the hardcore Mexican fight fan. They were there. But then the fight was so sensational, and both guys continued to win after that fight. When they met for their rematch like 2 years later, that was a main event. That was on pay-per-view, I believe. That was at the MGM Grand, and they sold the joint out. So great fights are the best promoters.
Yeah, I don't even want to talk over this. I'm actually watching this like a fan right now.
Score that knockout in round 9 in order to win, because they would not have let this fight continue with the condition of his eye. That's
it
why
was shut.
Yeah, and I think that drama added to the action, and that's why Vargas Miura was fight of the year in 2015, and in 2016 Vargas won that honor again with the help of Orlando Salido. He's got so many fight of the year candidates under his belt, like I can't even mention them all.
But you put the right fighters in the ring, like I said, they're great on offense, less so in other departments such as, you know, defense.
Yep.
And they just have the kind of mentalities where they don't want to take a backward step. They make for great fights.
Keep your tweets coming. And one more fight on the stream. That's going to be Luis Coria against Donald Molina coming up next. Keep your tweets coming. Just like Davis, who said, I just put on the Lamont Roach fight. It's over. Yes, Lamont Roach Jr. with a first-round KO. Virgil Ortiz, first-round KO. Cesar Diaz, a second-round KO. Moises Linares, who's out in Washington, D.C., Telemundo reporter, has already tweeted that he's got to go talk with the No Excuse Gym and the rest of the Golden Boy fighters in Washington, D.C.
Yeah, those are future stars.
Grand Doug Fisher here in Indio, California. And we, as much as we've been raving about Vargas and Mira, June, Doug, you and I were there, StubHub Center in Carson, California, the StubHub magic as Orlando City, Salido, and Francisco Vargas went at it. A draw, but the fans won. Let's look at some of the highlights from that fight.
Yeah, this was one of those fights where it's a rare occasion where a draw is still satisfying for fans. Usually fans want somebody to win, but these guys gave and took so much, the draw was fair.
5-year-old Salido, a lot of tread on that tire, just wondering if he still has enough in it to keep going. With a younger Francisco Vargas, who's fresh considering he's a Mexican fighter at the age of 30, only 24 fights. And Vargas letting his hands go a bit here in the second round. Uppercut nicely landed by Bandido.
Beautiful technique from Vargas. Got flipped with two overhand rights from Salido.
This is the kind of fight people were expecting immediately. They're expecting the action. This is why people spent some money to come to the StubHub Center, because they knew they wanted even work despite the free at times to see this one.
Didn't take long. These guys did not need to warm to the slugfest.
No, they're good.
Why wait?
I'm feeling not sure. We know what we're each other about.
I think it's good that Vargas is able to back Salido to the ropes. If Salido's coming forward, that's when he's most dangerous.
Good right landed by Vargas. He's in the black trunks.
Back ringside, Beth the Brand, Doug Fisher, and Luis Coria is ready to walk into the ring. And Coria lives in Indio, California. And there you see it, that ball man next to him. And this is Bill Rivera, regional singer in Mexico, really popular. He is walking in with Coria for his third professional fight as Coria is walking into El Moreno, sang by Lupio Rivera. There you see the Diaz brothers, Joel and Antonio. Joel is the manager, Antonio is the trainer for Coria. Art walking me with Golden Boy, and then also Gordia from Coachella Valley, used to live in Riverside. The dad would drive him the 2 hours to work with the Diaz brothers and said, forget it, there's something in this kid. We're gonna make the move, and here he is now. He's 18 years old. On Monday, he goes back to school. He's still in high school.
Schoolboy.
Yes, he is, as his social studies teacher called him Left Hook Louie.
I like that nickname. He could go by Schoolboy, he could go by Babyface Assassin. But Left Hook Louie, I like that too. It's got a ring to it. It's catchy.
Luis Coria sold over 400 tickets for this fight. And Doug, as I've told the story about Luis Coria and his family in Michoacan, they have a viewing party on the rancho. Where by viewing party, it means one of the cousins is charging the little kids 5 pesos because they set up a big outdoor venue on the ranch to check it out. A few hundred people are down there watching the fight tonight.
Division. Introducing to you first, fighting out of the blue corner, wearing red, trimmed in white, he weighed in officially 125 pounds. He enters the ring tonight for the fifth time as a professional, hailing from Chihuahua, Chihuahua, Mexico. Here is Gerardo El Toro Molina. And next, his opponent across the ring, fighting out of the red corner, wearing tonight blue trimmed in neon. He weighed in 125 and one half pounds. In two professional bouts, he stands perfect with 2 victories, no defeats, both wins coming by way of knockout. Here is the fighting pride of Indio, California, the undefeated Luis Coria. And your referee in charge of the action, Ray Corona.
Stop here, my ear's good, touch gloves. God bless.
Let's look at the tail of the tape for this fight.
Yeah, it's no big shocker here. Coria, the younger, taller, rangier man.
This one's scheduled for four rounds in the featherweight division. Luis Coria in the blue with the neon trim. His opponent, Gerardo Molina, 29 years old from Chihuahua, Chihuahua, Mexico. 1-3. Coria started boxing at a young age, introduced to the sport by his father.
He was a very good local amateur.
Sparred with Oscar Duarte, Virgil Ortiz, and Diego De La Hoya on the Joel Diaz camp at the Indio Boys and Girls Club.
And he can't get better work than that.
His third professional fight. Talking to him briefly yesterday, he said for his debut, he wasn't nervous. He said he was surprised by that, especially coming out of the amateurs, where sometimes you're fighting 3-4 times in a day. He said he feels comfortable now as a pro.
Yeah, I wouldn't describe him as nervous in his pro debut. I would have described him as over-anxious.
And good body shot landed by Coria.
He had 500 fans in the audience, and he wanted to put on a show, and he was just looking for that big left hook. Too soon. He just didn't set it up, so he didn't score a first round knockout. He scored a second round knockout. But once he found a home for that left hook, the fight was over. But he did smother himself a little bit. He's got a really good jab from the outside when he uses it. Like I said during the tell of the tape, it's obvious he's the taller, rangier guy, so you want to see him use his height and reach. But at the same time, he's 18 years old. He does have power. And he wants to use that as well. So sometimes these guys can get a little impetuous.
Good stiff jab, good left hook from Luis Coria.
He's got a nice straight right too, but he really cranks the left hook.
Coria, Coachella Valley High School. He has two younger sisters. Real soft-spoken. Uses the nickname King Louie. Left hook again, blocked partially by Valdez. The nickname isn't out of arrogance. It's that in eighth grade history class, they were learning about all the kings, King Henry VIII, and all the other kings along the way. Like, you know what? I like these guys. If you want to be the best, you're here. So he just started calling himself King Louis in eighth grade. And down, a big right stuns Valdez. I don't know how he stayed up.
Yeah, it looked like it crashed right into the temple of Valdez. I'm sorry if Molina.
Yeah, Molina. It was so good, we don't even know who it is. And here he is, letting his hands go a bit, is King Luis Coria.
Well, whoever he is, Molina's in trouble right now. He's fighting back, but he's also leaving himself open for these bombs from left hook Luis.
Oh, and he hits him right into the pillar, and it is over. It's done. A first round KO for King Luis Coria. Over 1,000 people were expected at that ranch in Mexico watching this. And they just saw their dude with a first round KO. Luvio Rivera jumps in. There's something about this kid that Joel Diaz tickets and he puts on a show.
Yeah, Coria delivers. And what was new in this fight was his right cross. His first two pro bouts, you didn't really see the right hand as a major weapon. And in this fight, it's the punch that hurt his opponent, Molina. And I believe he finished him with the right cross as well. Boom, overhand right, high on the forehead, just above the temple. Shakes the equilibrium of Gerardo Molina. Followed up with lefts, rights.
2 seconds, round number one. Referee Ray Corona puts a halt to this bout. Your winner by KO victory. He is still undefeated. Indio Zone, Luis Coria.
see Louis Correa with the first round KO.
She should keep her eye on this young man because he's going places. He's keeping his distance well, and the punch that ended it was another overhand right high on the head of Molina. Molina could not get his legs back. Just on instincts, he was kind of ducking and dodging some punches, but he couldn't evade them enough to keep being knocked into the corner. A good stoppage here.
Molina never went down, but I don't think he ever knew where he was at after that first big blow. Ray Corona, veteran referee, jumping in there, smart move. It was only a matter of time.
Yeah, even if he did know where he was, his body wasn't reacting the way it needed to react. You have to be able to stand on your two feet. You have to be able to defend yourself. And if you can't, there's no sense in letting the fight continue.
A lot of people loving Luis Cordia. King Louis. Do it. Name yourself. I'll name myself Pawn Duran, but you know, it don't quite have the ring. It's King Louis
right now. The thing is the kid is very humble. He's very down to earth. He's a great kid to talk to on record, yep, or just casually if you happen to run into he or his dad, you know, outside of the gym. They're good people.
Yeah, and one of the things that, you know, we're praising Joel Diaz and his camp here at India Boys and Girls Club with those fighters like Cesar Diaz, Virgil Ortiz, and Scordia, is if you follow their social media, these aren't kids bragging about, oh, I just got new shoes, or like, oh, this car. It's, we ran at 5 o'clock in the morning up hills, we're taking a nap, we're running, we're sparring with some of the best around, and then at night, Virgil Ortiz is playing his guitar. Luis Cordia is doing homework. And right. Virgil Cesar Diaz is back in Palmdale getting ready for the next day. So bright.